My dear student, colleagues, and all the viewers who are watching this program live from Facebook page, Physics Adda, I'd like to welcome to all in our International Physics Webinar. So it's our 60th International Physics Webinar. So good evening to all here in Bangladesh, and a very good afternoon to all those who are watching this program live from Switzerland. So hope you are well and safe from corona pandemic. So all we know that we are staying in a corona pandemic situation. So we cannot continue our normal academic program inside the campus. So we have to start our online program to continue our normal program. So our Department of Physics, Pabna University of Science and Technology, has started its online program, including online classes and online international physics webinar. So in those physics webinars, physicists from different countries are coming as a main speaker, and they are sharing their experience with our student, and they are delivering their speech, and they're sharing their knowledge with our student. And I think by this way, our students are benefited. So we are trying to adjust with this new normal situation. And today is very important day for our department, as we would like to arrange a webinar today. And in those webinars, so we got a physicist from Switzerland. So today I'd like to welcome you all to a joint session between the Department of Physics, Pabna University of Science and Technology, and the Department of Theoretical Physics, Center of Astroparticle Physics, Geneva Physics Section, Geneva University of Geneva, Switzerland, in cosmology. So, and we have with us here today Dr. Francisco Lepuri, postdoc researcher, Department of Theoretical Physics, Center for Astroparticle Physics, Geneva Physics Section, Faculty of Science, University of Geneva, Switzerland, connecting with us from Switzerland through online. So she has already connected with us. So I'd like to welcome our speaker. So madam, good evening and good afternoon to your part. Thanks for accepting our invitation, and we'd like to say thanks on the behalf of the Department of Physics, Pabna University of Science and Technology. So you have already come to know that we have arranged a series of webinars. So today is our 60th. And for those who are new, I'd like to inform that, first of all, we'd like to introduce our speaker with all of you, and then you have a time. In that time, our speaker will deliver his speech, and at the end we have a discussion session. In that time, actually, anybody can join with us. I think we have already come to know the title of today's International Physics Webinar. Title is the Relativistic Cosmology in the Era of Large Scale Survey, and our speaker is Dr. Francisco Lepuri, postdoc researcher, Department of Theoretical Physics, Center for Astroparticle Physics, Geneva Physics Section, Faculty of University of Geneva, Switzerland. And we can see she is currently Department of Theoretical Physics, University of Geneva, and she has completed his master's degree from in theoretical physics from University of Trieste, Italy, and his PhD from SISSA, International School for Advanced Studies, Trieste, Italy, and now she is working as a postdoc researcher at the University of Geneva. So we can see her ResearchGate ID. You can see that her ResearchGate point is 14.45. So thanks all for all of your patience. Now it's time to go to our speaker. So welcome again, madam. So it's your time, you can start your session.
Thank you, thank you. So I already share my screen, then I will start my presentation.
Yeah.
So good evening, everyone. I'm Francesca. I would like first to thank the organizer of this seminar to give me the opportunity to speak. And I work as a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Geneva, and my research mainly focuses on the large scale structure of the universe. Today, however, I would like to give a more introductory seminar on cosmology. In particular, I would like to revise the different steps that took cosmology to evolve from a discipline that was in the beginning just speculation to the data-driven science that we know nowadays. So what is cosmology about? Cosmology is a very ambitious science. It aims basically to study the universe as a whole entity. And in particular, what we as cosmologists try to do is to try to understand what are the physical mechanisms that regulates the evolution of the universe. And we would like also to reconstruct the past history of the universe and maybe to determine what will be the future evolution of the universe itself. And of course, these questions are not new questions. The humankind has been wondering about the origin of the universe since thousands of years ago. And what changed with modern cosmology is the tools that we use to describe the universe. So we can actually say that nowadays, cosmology tries to answer to very ancient questions using some modern tools. And this became possible thanks to the advancement of both technologies and theory. And so what we want to do with my seminar is first describe the path that brought to the current understanding of the universe. And just a little spoiler to what we will see. Basically, the way we today understand the universe is in the so-called Hobsbawm framework. So we think that the universe in the past was in a form of a very dense matter and radiation, and the universe expanded in time, forming the structure that we see today. So stars, galaxies, and cluster of galaxies, and so on. And within this Hobsbawm framework, cosmologists kind of outline a concordance model. This concordance model is called lambda CDM, that means lambda called dark matter. We will see later better what are the two components of this model, but I just want to point out that the name itself of this concordance model highlights what are the things that nowadays we don't understand about the universe. So in the second part of the seminar, in the final part, I would like to highlight what, as cosmology, we plan to do in order to understand what is currently not clear about the universe itself. So we said that we want to understand as the universe works as a whole. This is a very ambitious ambitious task. And as physicists, when we want to solve a very difficult problem, we usually use some assumption to simplify our problems. And in the field of cosmology, there are mainly two pillars that you use to simplify the problems. The first one is the so-called cosmological principle. So what we say is that in the universe, there are not privileged location or direction. Or in a more technical way, we can say that the universe is homogeneous and isotropic on large scales. And this statement raises another question, that is, what does it mean, large scales? In fact, large scales is relative basically to what we can observe. If we think about how we could conceive the universe 1 century or 2 centuries ago, our universe was basically the solar system. And if we look at the solar system, we know that the cosmological principle is not valid on this case. In fact, we know that the greatest part of the mass in the solar system is concentrated in the center. Let's go, not really in the center, but in the sun. So these are not the large scale that we're talking about in cosmology. Let's move to larger scales. We can consider the scale of a galaxy, like the nearby galaxy Andromeda. And also in the galaxy, we can see that the mass is mainly concentrated in the center of the galaxy itself. So let's move further to larger scales, and let's consider the largest picture that we can take of our distribution of galaxy. And this is a picture taken from the Hubble Space Telescope that counts around 10,000 galaxies. And we see that if we look at individual patches of this image, we see that they look similar to each other. So these are the scales that can be considered large for cosmology, and we consider cosmological scales. So let's see a bit more detail what it means for the universe to be homogeneous and isotropic. If we take, for example, this map, and if we look at some individual patches of the sky, we see that they all look the same. In a more detailed way, for example, if we count the number of galaxies in one of these patches, we will see that we will find more or less the same number of sources. This is saying us that there are not privileged locations in our universe, and this is the concept of homogeneity. Let's move forward. What does it mean that there are not privileged directions in the universe? So let's take, for example, this map of galaxy. This is from the Galaxy Survey SDSS. That is one of the largest current galaxy survey at our disposal. And how do we interpret this? So each one of these points that we observe in this picture is a galaxy. And the point of view of the observation is situated in the center of this circle. And the radius basically gives you an indication of the distance between the observer and the sources. And you may also notice that you have some black area. This is just due to the fact that there is some dust in our galaxy that prevents us to observe in this given direction. However, if we observe, for example, in the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere, we see that the distribution of the galaxy is more or less the same. It doesn't depend in the direction in which we point our telescope. And this is telling us that the isotropy is a reasonable assumption for describing the universe on large scales. So this was the first pillar. The second pillar in modern cosmology is that when we consider cosmological scales that we have just described, gravity is the main actor on stage. this is an assumption that simplifies the problem. It means that we don't need to care about, for example, electromagnetic interaction that occurs on very small scales. And starting from the beginning of last century, we have a theory of gravity, that is general relativity, that is able to describe the gravitational interaction on large scales. And starting up with the affirmation of general relativity, we also have seen the first mathematical cosmological models that that we have developed. However, we will come back in more detail on this. We will see that many concepts in cosmology can be also described without assuming general relativity. Okay, now I want to go through the three main observational facts that led to the formation of the Hot Big Bang framework to describe the evolution of our universe. These three observational facts are the Hilbert paradox, the Hubble law, and the cosmic microwave background observation. So the Hilbert paradox was formulated in the 19th century, way before the formulation of general relativity, and is basically due to the fact that when we look at the sky at night, the sky looks dark. So let's see why this is a paradox. So at that point in the 19th century, the main cosmological model that we had was the one of a universe that is static, and we were observing stars, and we could assume that the average density of these stars were constant. So what do we observe of a star? We observe the apparent flux of a star that depends on the intrinsic luminosity of the star, that is this L here, and the distance R that between the observer and a star. And let's assume that if we want to model how many stars we observe, we have that the number of stars is determined by the number density of stars that, as we say, we consider constant. And in each infinitesimal sphere, this will be proportional to the surface of the sphere times the infinitesimal width of the sphere itself. And okay, if we want to compute that, let's try to compute the total energy density of this flux that we receive from the stars at night. We just need to integrate the apparent flux. And if we substitute the expression for the apparent flux and the expression for the number of stars that we observe, we see that this expression diverge. So we at night, if we believe that our universe is static and the number of density is constant, we would expect to see a nice sky that is very luminous. So the question is, why do we see a nice sky that instead is dark? And there are several possible solutions to this problem. The first one was formulated by Hilbert itself, and he thought that there was some process due, for example, to the intergalactic interstellar gas that was somehow absorbing the emission from the stars, and for this reason we would not observe a fully luminous star. A second possible solution is that the universe is finite in size, and therefore if we look at the previous expression, let's see if I can. Here you don't have to integrate from zero to infinity, but only up to a given radius. And or you could also assume that the stars are distributed only in a finite size of the universe. In this case, however, you will violate the cosmological principle. And a third explanation is that the universe is not eternal, but has a finite age. And the fourth explanation is that the light coming from a star is dimmer for stars that are farther from us. And as we will see within the Hot Big Bang model framework, the three and four are the true explanation that we give to the Hilbert paradox. Okay, second observational fact is the Hubble law. That was the first evidence of the expansion of our universe. So we are at the beginning of the 20th century, and we were able at that point to observe galaxy spectra. So galaxy spectra is simply the intensity of the light that we see from a galaxy as a function of its frequency. And if we look at galaxy spectra, we could see that there were some features in the spectra that are absorption line or emission line. And we know that the emission line or absorption line are affected by the motion of the source itself. This means that a source that is moving farther away, that has a radial velocity positive, so it's moving farther away from us, will be redshifted, while a source that is moving toward us will be blue-shifted. So if we call, for example, lambda e, the rest frame wavelength of our emitted light, and we call lambda zero, lambda o, the observed wavelength, we can define the redshift as the relative difference between the two. And okay, we talk about redshift if this quantity is positive, while we talk about blue shift if this quantity is negative. And at the beginning of the 20th century, Slither measured the radial velocity of spiral nebulae of galaxy, and realized that there was a huge asymmetry between galaxies that were receding from us and that manifest a positive redshift, and galaxies that were instead moving toward us that were therefore showing a negative blue shift. And this observation was extended by Eddington later, and he found that this asymmetry was even more striking. So at that point, the probability that you have a flux of galaxy moving farther away from us and was extremely small. So Hubble decided to further investigate this fact, and he decided to compute the redshift of the galaxy and to show them as a function of the distance. This distance was measured in an independent way. And by showing this data in a plot, so in this plot we see the velocity measured through the redshift and the distance between the galaxy, you show that there was a very huge correlation. This means that farther away the galaxy are from us, faster they are moving away from us. And what he did was basically just to fit this correlation with the straight line, and he found that apart from a huge scatter due to the uncertainty in the measure at that time, there was a straight line was a very good assumption for this fact. And nowadays we use the same technique to measure this proportionality between the velocity and the distance, and we call this proportionality Hubble factor, and it's measured today to be around 70 kilometers per second over megaparsec. This is not very important, but I just want to mention that there are also different ways that nowadays you use to infer the value of this Hubble factor, and there are some actually experiments that are giving not consistent results. So at the moment in the cosmology community, measuring this factor is zero it's a big thing, and trying to explain why different probes give different values is it's also a hot topic of research. But for the moment, let's say that we don't care about this, and let's see how can we understand the fact that the velocity, the receding velocity of the galaxy is proportional to the distance. And if we think about the cosmological principle, indeed this is not surprising. So what we can do is that let's imagine that we have a triangle of galaxy, 1, 2, 3, with their relative distance, d1, d2, and d3. And we want to see how the distance at a given time, t0, is related to the distance at the generic time d. If we assume that the cosmological principle is valid, the scaling of this distance is a simple function of time. In fact, if we think about homogeneity, this means that alpha t does not depend on the position, just depends on the time, while the fact that our universe is isotropic means that there is no rotation, there is no shear, and this scale factor is just a scalar quantity. So what we can do is to compute the relative velocity between, for example, the galaxy 1 and the galaxy 2 by simply taking the derivative of this function d1 of t. And if we take the derivative, we can indeed recover the relation that was found by Hubble, that the fact that the radial velocity is proportional up to a certain function of time to the distance itself of the galaxy. And in this case, we are able to find also how this function of time should look like. For the moment, we are not saying that it's a constant, we're just saying that it's a function of time. And so this was the first evidence that our universe was expanding and that the galaxy farther away were receding from us. And at this point, so the question, we know that currently the universe is undergoing an expansion phase. But at that point, in the 50s, 60s, there was a huge question that was, we could say, tormenting the cosmology community. So how was the universe in the past? And in particular, there were two competing theories about how we should think about the universe in the past. One of them was saying that the universe look in the past was very similar to how it looks like, and another one was saying that the universe was very different from how we see it now. And these two theories are the steady state theory and the Big Bang theory, the one that we know today. And curiously enough, the term Big Bang theory was actually coined by one of the people that were supporting the steady state theory, that is Fred Hoyle. And let me just say that the steady state theory is what is this saying? Is a model that is still compatible with expansion of the universe and assume the so-called perfect cosmological principle. So it's saying that basically all the global quantity of the universe are constant in time. So our Hubble factor, according to the steady state model, should not depend on time, and the average density of the universe should not depend on time. So if we take seriously this statement, we can then write the Hubble law with a constant factor, and we see that our distance between us and a certain source should increase exponentially with time. And if we look at the mean density rho zero, and we assume that this also does not depend on time, what we found is that the steady state theory requires matter to be created. So you are basically this steady state theory can still assume a universe that is stationary, that has always been more or less the same, but the price to pay is that you need to give away the conservation of energy. So at the time, there were not observational proof that this theory was wrong. But it's important to mention that the Big Bang theory was predicting something that was going to be observed very soon. And the idea is that if the universe is expanding and if the mass is conserved, in the past, the universe was occupying, let's say, a smaller volume, and for this reason was in a much denser state than it is now. So let's say that our universe is made of atoms, where we have protons and electrons. If we compress this atom in a very small volume, what we see is that at a certain point, this atom will break. So we will not have atom anymore, but we will have a proton, a neutron, and electrons. And if we have charged particles, we know that light interacts with these particles. In particular, in the primordial universe, where radiation and matter were interacting with each other, the light was basically trapped between this fluid of charged particles. So as the universe expands, at a certain point, you start to form atoms. And so what you observe is that light is not trapped anymore. So the universe that until that point was opaque becomes at a certain point transparent. And this light, these photons, basically will free stream and until now. So what the supporter, let's say, of the Big Bang theory were claiming is that this light from the very early stages of the universe started after the recombination of the atom to free stream toward us, should be an almost uniformly distributed radiation, and we should be able to see it today. So this was the so-called cosmic microwave background. And so in the 60s, there were some people in Princeton or Harvard, I don't remember, that were trying to build an experiment to observe this cosmic microwave background radiation. And in the 64, two engineers that were working on a not cosmological experiment for the first time actually discovered this effect that was predicted by the Big Bang theory. And so these two people were Penzias and Wilson, and they were basically working with a huge antenna, an ultra-sensitive antenna, and they needed to clean basically the signal detected by this antenna by any possible source of noise. So even after they took into account of all possible source of noise, they found this background radiation that they could not explain and they were not able to get rid of. And after reading the paper of Gamow and Halffter, that were the people that for the first time theorized the existence of this cosmic microwave background, understood that the source of the noise was indeed this primordial radiation. And in the 78, they received the Nobel Prize for this discovery, and this was the confirmation that the Big Bang theory was more suitable to describe what we observed compared to the steady state theory. It was the first success of the Big Bang theory against the steady state theory. Okay. We have detected this cosmic microwave background, and cosmology in the next decades try to get as much as information as possible from this cosmic microwave background. And in the late 80s, NASA sent in space a satellite, COBE, whose goal was indeed to study the radiation coming from this primordial phase of the universe. And what they did was to map the intensity of this radiation as the function of the frequency. And what they discovered is that this intensity was described very well by a black body spectrum. It is this function that I show here. And by fitting with their data this black body spectrum, they were able to measure the temperature associated to this primordial radiation, that is around 3 Kelvin. And you see that from this plot that there is a very good agreement between what was between this expected black body spectrum and the measurements from COBE. And the reason is that this is a proof that in this primordial phase of the universe was indeed opaque, because this is a typical spectrum that you have for opaque objects. And so, as I say, COBE was a satellite, and so what a satellite do is basically to make rounds around the Earth, and in this way it was able really to map this radiation that is coming from every direction in all the directions to see whether it was perfectly homogeneous or not. And let's see more or less how this works. So we are in a certain location in our galaxy, and we send a satellite to map the cosmic microwave background radiation. And so what we have from the data that we have from this telescope is basically an intensity map of this radiation on the surface of a sphere. So for better visualization, what usually people do is to project this sphere on a plane. And there are many different ways to do that. The one that is most common for the CMB is this small white projection. And you can observe in different frequency. And for the cosmic microwave background, since this radiation is coming from the early universe, the redshift is very large. So we want to observe in the microwave. And what COBE saw is that this radiation was highly homogeneous. So to see deviation from homogeneity, you really need to increase the contrast and look very carefully. And this is the final result, let's say. And you see that the main source of inhomogeneities is given by this plane that is just due to the dust that we have inside our galaxy. And let's say that we are able to model the contamination from all the radiation that is coming from inside our galaxy, so we are able to clean this map from this contamination. Then the result that we would get would be this one. So this is the map of the anisotropy of the cosmic microwave background as they were mapped by COBE in the 92, then from the successor of COBE, WMAP, in the 2003, and finally from Planck in the 2013. There are also some more recent maps, 2018. And you see that the radiation of the cosmic microwave background is not exactly homogeneously distributed in every direction, but there are some anisotropy. And this anisotropy has been measured and have been found to be very small. So what this is telling us is that in the past, the universe was very close to be exactly homogeneous and anisotropic. While if we look at the local universe nowadays, we see that we have a huge structure, we have galaxy, we have cluster of galaxies, so we are far from these very small anisotropies. Okay, it's a good time to make a summary of what we've seen. So what we've seen is that the Olbers paradox, the Hubble observation, and the cosmic microwave background had led to a formation of the old Big Bang model as the model that is able to describe the evolution of our universe, or at least what we can observe of our universe nowadays. And we also seen that we apply the cosmological principle that is valid on very large scales. However, the observation of the cosmic microwave background are telling us that there are some very tiny homogeneity anisotropies. And we know that in the past, these deviations were extremely small. So the question is that, is there a theoretical framework that you can use to describe this model, to describe what we had observed. And the answer is yes, we can describe this in the framework of general relativity. And I don't want to enter in the detail, but I will just stress some main points. And in general relativity, the central object is the metric. That is what allows us to compute the distance between two neighboring points. And you probably are familiar with the Euclidean matrix. So if we want to compute the distance between two points in a Euclidean space, we just sum the infinitesimal, if we take, for example, Cartesian coordinate, we sum the infinitesimal distance in each of the coordinates. So in this way, if we want to write this infinitesimal distance in a compact way, we can use this formally, introducing this metric g nu nu, and we have that in Euclidean space, this metric is simply an identity matrix. So special relativity told that things are a bit more complicated. And instead of having a concept of distance between two points, we have the concept of distance between two events. So an event is everything that happens in a given point in space and at a given time. And similarly to what we do with the Euclidean space, we can define the separation between two events. And we have this separation is determined by a metric that, in the case of the Minkowski space-time, is the Minkowski metric. And what these two frameworks have in common is that you can find a suitable, simple coordinate system in a way that your metric is static, doesn't change, and there are not unknown quantities in the metric. So the take-home message from general relativity is that the metric in full generality can be very complicated. But what people do when you want to apply general relativity is usually start with the most generic form of your metric and then using some assumption to simplify this generic form. And in particular, in cosmology, what we want to use is the cosmological principle. And if you take a generic form of the metric and you apply the cosmological principle, you find that the general form of the metric simplifies significantly. And what you arrive is the Friedman-Lemaître-Robertson-Walker metric, that is the one that I wrote down here. And it's a very long expression, just to acknowledge all the people that contributed to compute this metric. And you see that the complication that comes compared, for example, to the Minkowski metrics are this scale factor that is basically telling you how the universe is expanding in time. And then there is this other function here that is basically related to the spatial curvature of your space-time. And in an homogeneous and isotropic universe, there are only three possibilities for the spatial curvature. One is that the universe has a positive curvature. So this means that it looks like the 3D generalization of the surface of a sphere. Then you can have a spatial part of your metric that is Euclidean, so it's flat. And this is the generalization to 3D to a plane. And then you can have a negative curvature that is the generalization to 3D to this form of hyperbolic space. Okay, so this is the, assuming that cosmological principle, we arrive to this form of the metric. And we need to think about, in GR, about the meaning of the coordinate that we use. In particular, if we look at this time, there is no universal time in general relativity. So the time coordinate that you observe is always relative to an observer. But we can interpret this time t here as the proper time that would be measured by an observer that is co-moving with the expansion of the universe. And instead, the proper distance is the distance that would be measured by an observer at a given time t0, the distance between a source and observer measured at a given time t0. Okay, let's see that if we can reinterpret the cosmological redshift in function of this Friedman-Lemaître-Robertson-Walker metric. So using this metric, we can see how the distances scale as a function of time. And we know that the proper distance just scale with a scale factor. And the same thing can be said for the wavelength of a photon. So the wavelength of a photon at the given time, at emission, as the time as it emitted of the source, will be just the scale factor at the time of the emission, times the observed wavelength of the photon, and we are assuming here that we can properly normalize the scale factor to be just one at the observer, and in this way we can just take the expression that we had before for the redshift and relate this to the scale factor. And what you see here that we have a direct relation between the redshift and the scale factor, and we know that the scale factor is a function of time, of this proper time. So this means that we basically can, let's say, label the different time of the different time evolution of the universe with three parameters, let's say. One is the proper time, one is the scale factor, and one is the redshift. Let me just stress that the redshift is an observable, something that we observe. Okay, so at this point we have this generic expression of the metric, and we don't know anything about how the scale factor looks like. And in order to understand how the scale factor evolved, we need to consider the Einstein field equation. So the Einstein field equation basically offer you a relation between the geometric part of space-time that is given by the metric, and the matter energy content of the space-time that is given by this thing you knew that is called stress energy tensor. So if you assume the cosmological principle, and let me assume for the moment also that we are in a specially flat universe, you can write down this very complex system of equations that are Einstein field equations in a simplified form that basically relates the Hubble factor, H, to the energy density content of the universe given by this rho of t. There is another assumption here, is that this stress energy tensor is given by a perfect fluid, just to be precise. And this equation, this relation between the Hubble factor and the density in the universe is called Friedmann equation. And as you see, there are two unknown quantities in this equation. One is the scale factor and one is the energy density of the universe. And we only have one equation, so we need something else if we want to fully characterize our system. And this something else is given by the so-called fluid equation. So let's imagine that we have a commuting volume in our universe, so a volume that is expanding with the Hubble flow. And the total energy of the universe is given by the energy density of the universe times the volume of this commuting ball, let's say. And this volume is, since this size of the universe is commuting with the Hubble flow, will be proportional to the scale factor to the power 3. So what we can do then is we can consider the first law of thermodynamics. That is relating basically the change in energy to the change in volume and the heat flow at the boundary of our box. In cosmology, we can assume that there is not heat flow at the boundary of our universe, so that the right-hand side of this expression is just zero. And we can write this as a differential equation in terms of density and in terms of pressure. So here we just substitute the expression of the total energy and the expression of the volume. And we see that we didn't really solve the problem. At this point, we have two equations and we have three unknowns. The unknowns are the scale factor, the density, and the pressure. And so what we need is an equation of state that is relating the density, the energy density of our universe, and the pressure of our universe. And in general, this equation of states can be very complicated, but in cosmology, we usually assume that we have very simple form of matter. So we can assume a simple proportionality between the energy density of the universe and the pressure. And in particular, the two main forms of energy density that we're interested in cosmology is the one of a non-relativistic gas that we call also pressureless matter or dust. And this form of matter is characterized by a pressure that is identically zero. And then another form of energy density that we're interested in is a relativistic gas of particles or radiation. And in this case, we have that this factor of proportionality is simply one-third. Okay, so at this point, our system is closed. And what we can do, we can combine the Friedmann equation with the fluid equation. And if we combine these two equations, we found an equation for a differential equation for the rate of expansion of our universe. So this is the second derivative of the scale factor. So it's telling us how the rate of expansion is changing as a function of the energy density. And this W is the proportionality in the equation of state of your fluid. So what we notice here is that what's interesting to study in this equation is the sign of this second derivative. In fact, if the second derivative of the scale factor is positive, this means that the expansion of the universe is accelerating, while if the second derivative of the scale factor is negative, this means that the expansion of the universe is decelerating. And what we find if you study the sign of this differential equation is that the acceleration the acceleration increase if W is larger of minus one third. Yeah, there is a typo in my presentation. So we have an accelerated expansion when this W is larger of minus one third. And let me define a new form of energy density that we call dark energy. This is the one that gives you it is something that gives you an accelerated expansion. And you see, this is very generic. To have dark energy, you basically need a W that is smaller than minus one third. And inside this full set of possibility to have in dark energy models, we can find a subset that is called cosmological constant, where this W is simply equal to minus one. Okay, so now the question is that if we assume something reasonable for the energy density content of the universe, do we expect an expansion that is accelerated or decelerated? And the ordinary energy density that we know is given basically by matter and radiation. And so if we assume that we just have matter and radiation, let's take, for example, a commoving sphere of matter, we see that as the universe expands, the Narmer density of this matter will decrease as 1 over the volume. And for this reason, if we look at the previous equation with the energy density is decreasing, we also expect that the Hubble rate is decreasing. And a similar thing can be said for the radiation. Just for the radiation, we have an extra factor, is the energy density of the radiation decays faster because the energy density of a photon also depends on the wavelength that is also it also evolves with the Hubble flow. But the take-home message from these slides for me was that in a universe where we have only matter and radiation, we expect that the expansion of the universe is decelerated. Okay, and is there a way that we can use to check if this is true or not? Is it possible to describe our universe just with matter and radiation? And before going to the conclusion, to the answer, let's just reformulate a bit the Friedmann equation that we've seen before. So this is the Friedmann equation. We can, for a multi-fluid component, we can just write the total energy as the sum of the individual contribution. And it's very common for cosmology to express this equation in terms of critical parameters that is given by simply the density of a certain component divided by the critical density that is given by this combination of the Hubble factor and the gravitational constant at time T0. This means nowadays. And we can write the Friedmann equation in terms of this critical parameter and as a function of redshift. And the reason why we want to write it as a function of redshift is that, as I mentioned before, the redshift is observable. And so this Friedmann equation here is telling us that we can actually see how the Hubble factor is changing, how the expansion of the universe is accelerating or not by mapping as a function of redshift the Hubble factor. So the question is that, are we able to map as a function of redshift the Hubble factor or some function of the Hubble factor? And the answer to this question is given by the so-called standard candles. So let's say that we have our telescope and we observe a source, and this source is a standard candle. This means that emits with a known intrinsic luminosity. So we know that photons follow null geodesics, and for this reason, we can, by assuming the photon travel on null geodesics, we can just write the proper distance as a function of the scale factor. And let's change the variable because we know that we observe Reshi, we don't observe the scale factor. And if we write it in terms of the scale factor, we just found that the proper distance is an integration of the Hubble rate along between the telescope and the source. So what we know is that the proper distance is a quantity that accounts the expansion history from the source to the observer. Now, the problem is that the proper distance is not something that we can measure. So we need to find something that we can indeed measure. And what we can measure is the so-called luminosity distance. That is a combination of the intrinsic luminosity of the source that we assume we know if we have if we're observing standard candles, and the observed flux of the source. This is the same relation that I showed when I was discussing the Olbers paradox. The Olbers paradox. And this luminosity distance coincides with the proper distance only if we assume that we have a Euclidean space. But if we assume instead that we have an expanding space and a curved space, it's related to the proper distance, but it's not exactly the proper distance. But the advantage is that the luminosity distance is still a function of the proper distance, still a function of the Hubble rate, but it's something that is directly measurable. So now the question is that, do we know any standard candle? And the standard candle that are used in cosmology are type 1a supernovae. So type 1a supernovae, a supernova in general is it starts as at the end of its fate and an explosion of star. And these type 1a supernovae are supernovae that originate from a binary system where one of the stars in this binary system is a white dwarf, is a compact object. So what happens is that if this white dwarf is able to accrete mass from the companion star, it can if it reaches a certain critical mass, at some point this can trigger an explosion of the star itself. And this event is extremely luminous, so it's something that we can observe very clearly. We can measure its spectra, and in the spectra there are some emission lines, so we can measure the redshift of this type 1a supernovae. And so the question is that do they always do this type 1a supernovae have the same luminosity? And the answer is not really. But it's possible to make them standard. They are standardizable candles in a way that they have not the same luminosity. But if you look at the luminosity, like in this plot, as a function of time, there is a correlation between the peak luminosity and the slope, the decay that you have at the faint end of this curve. So in this way, you can rescale your light curve, and you can make the supernova standardizable candle. So you can use it to measure the luminosity distance. This has been done in kind of recently at the end of the 20th century, and it was done by two independent groups. And both these groups found evidence for an accelerating expansion of the universe today. That in 2011, the main leader of these two groups received a Nobel Prize for the discovery of an accelerating expansion of the universe through observation of distant supernovae. And this is what they observe here in this plot on, on the x-axis. You have the redshift of your source, while on the y-axis you have something that is related, let's say, to the luminosity distance. And what they observe is that their data points were pointing with a certain statistical significance toward a universe that is whose expansion is accelerating. Okay, so the question is, we know that we need some dark energy component, and the simplest way to have dark energy is to have a cosmological constant. And nowadays, with the cosmological constant, we are able to explain a wide variety of observation. However, it poses some some conceptual problem. Let's see what they are. The first conceptual problem is to give a physical interpretation to this cosmological constant. And the first choice would be to the one of having a vacuum energy that is triggering this this cosmological constant. And we know that from quantum field theory that vacuum energy due to some quantum mechanics effect would give rise to an effect that is similar to the cosmological constant. So ideally, if we could observe a cosmological constant that is the same that we are able to predict from quantum field theory, we would be very happy, and in our model, we would not have any problem. Now, in practice, the cosmological constant that we observe is 120 order of magnitude smaller than the cosmological constant that has been predicted from quantum field theory. So what does it mean? This means is that our observed cosmological constant must be a combination of these vacuum energy cosmological constants plus some effective cosmological constant whose origin is not clear. And especially the value of this effective cosmological constant whose origin is not clear must be very big and opposite in sign to the one estimated by quantum field theory to trigger an observed cosmological constant that is that small. So this is the so-called fine-tuning problem. And the second problem is related to the fact that we are now able, with observation, to estimate the amount of dark energy that we have today, the amount of cosmological constant that we have today, and the amount of matter. And what we found that the two are comparable. So it seems really unlikely that we live in a phase of the life of the universe where these two quantities are more or less are very close to each other. This is the so-called coincidence problem. So for this reason, cosmologists have tried to find alternative to the cosmological constants, even if nowadays there is not any model that is really preferred to the cosmological constant itself. Okay, let me just look at the time. Okay, I think I still have some time. Okay, so let's summarize what we have seen. So what we've seen is that we live in an expanding universe, and this universe is well described within the hot Big Bang framework. This means that the universe has been through different phases, and we know that currently the expansion of the universe is accelerated. And this is this in this storyline, we just see the main phase of the life of the universe, and let me just go through them because there is, we didn't really see in detail everything. So, in the very early phase of the universe, cosmologists think nowadays that there was a phase that is called inflation. And inflation is a framework to describe the initial phase of the life of the universe, and it was first introduced to solve some problems of the hot Big Bang framework. But the important things about inflation is that it's a mechanism that provides us with the initial condition of our universe. So provides us with some initial quantum fluctuation that are able to grow and to form either the anisotropy, both the anisotropy that we see in the cosmic microwave background, but also all the structure or the galaxies over density and other density that we observe today, for example, in galaxy surveys. And after inflation, we had a phase we have seen where the universe was opaque, so light and matter were tightly coupled to each other. And at a certain point, as the atoms can form, as the atom electron and proton can recombine to form atom, we have that the photons are able to free stream, and this is the surface, the last scattering surface, that is what we observe with the cosmic microwave background. So after this, there is a phase where the universe is basically neutral, and the overdensity were not large enough to form objects that we observe today, for example, stars on galaxy. And at a certain point, we know that gravity tends to cluster objects, and we have the first star are born, and since gravity tends to take stars and put them together to form bigger structure, we see that at a certain point galaxies are also formed, and then we arrive in the phase of the universe, in the local universe as we observe it today. Okay, this is way beyond to what we have seen up to now, so let me try to give you a clue on how we know these things. So nowadays, the main cosmological observation, as I already mentioned, is coming from the analysis of the anisotropies of the cosmic microwave background. So the question is that we have this map of intensity, and we have some region, some direction, where we have a larger intensity, that is this, this red spot, and some region where we have a smaller intensity that is given by this blue spot. And the question is that why can we infer things about the universe from this? And what is very crucial to understand is that our model does not predict an exact initial condition. This means that we are not able to say in a given direction of the sky, I will see a CMB temperature of a given value. Our model is able to predict the statistics of this fluctuation. So what we actually are able to measure and to compare with our model are how the temperature in a given direction T is correlated to all the other pixels in the map. And this information is encoded in a so-called correlation function that in harmonic space is called angular power spectrum. So in here, this is what has been measured by the cosmic microground correlation. In the y-axis, you have this correlation function. And in the x-axis, you have the angular scale, the angular separation between the two pixels that you are correlating. And you have that for small value of L, you are basically looking how the larger scales are correlated, while on large values of L, you are looking how the small scales are correlated. And in this plot, we show in this dot what the Planck satellite observed, while in this blue line, we have the prediction from our theoretical model. And we see that there is an amazing agreement between the two. And let's see what are the different components of this spectrum. We have first, on the larger scales, this plateau that is encodes the main information on the initial condition of the universe. Then we have some oscillating feature that are called baryon acoustic oscillation. We will see a bit better later. And then we have a damping that is due to photon diffusion at recombination. So the question is that why do we have this baryon acoustic oscillation there? And we need to understand a bit what's happening in the very early universe and in this fluid that we had in the very early universe. So the idea is that we have radiation and we have baryons, and photons and baryons are tightly coupled, interact with each other. And there are two competing effects in this photon-baryon fluid. One is the radiation pressure that will tend to make this fluid expand, and one is gravity that will tend to compress the fluid. So you have basically this pressure and gravity that together generate a sound wave, and this sound wave propagates in the early universe until the atom recombine. And the distance that was traveled by the sound wave is exactly encoded in this angular power spectrum, and is giving the distance and is given basically the frequency of this oscillation that we have seen in the cosmic microwave background. And so you see that the full shape of this power spectrum will depend on the initial condition, on the amount of baryons that you have, on the amount of photons, on the fraction of the total matter and the amount of baryons. And by fitting your theoretical expectation with the observed data, you are able to measure all these cosmological parameters. And the picture of the universe that emerges from this measurement is the following. So our universe is very close to be spatially flat, or exactly spatially flat for some reason. And we have different components. The dominant component is a dark energy component that is almost 70% of the universe. Then we have a small fraction of the remaining matter under the form of baryons that is around 5%. And then we have around 27% of the matter that is under a form of matter that does not interact with photon. And we call this matter dark matter. And So this is mainly coming from the observation of the CMB. However, in cosmology, we have also other kinds of observation that will be particularly promising for better understanding this picture that now doesn't look very clear in the future. And this is the large-scale structural distribution of galaxies. So what we want to do and what has been done in the past decades with the distribution of galaxies is very similar to what we do with the CMB intensity maps. So we have a map of galaxy, and we can observe galaxy with a given redshift in a given position in the sky. So what we want to do is to see how the fluctuation in the number of galaxy in different points of this map are correlated to each other. So what we can do is to define an observable that is called galaxy number count, that is the difference between the number of galaxies that I observe in one of these pixels and the average number of galaxies that I observe along the whole direction. And in first approximation, we can say that this fluctuation in the number of galaxies is simply related to the fluctuation in the density of matter that we observe compared to an homogeneous distribution of matter. And this is given by the expression here, where we have two say ingredients. One is the density fluctuation of matter, as I said, and one is the so-called galaxy bias, that is basically the relation between your observed fluctuation in the number density of galaxy and your fluctuation in the density. And what is really important is that the same feature that we observe in the CMB, given by this baryon acoustic oscillation, can also be observed in the correlation function of galaxy. And this will correspond to a bump, an excess of correlation, exactly at the distance that corresponds to the sound horizon. It is the distance that is traveled from this sound wave from the early universe until recombination. It corresponds to around 150 megaparsec. And you see that this peak in the correlation function of galaxy was first detected in 2005 and is one of the main targets for future cosmological observation. And the reason is that this baryon acoustic oscillation scale is called a standard ruler. This means that it's a fixed scale and that we can measure, for example, taking sample of galaxy at different redshift and using the relation between this fixed scale that we are able to measure in observable coordinates, studying the relation between these observable coordinates and the distance, we are really able to reconstruct the expansion history of the universe, because we know that if you observe, for example, in redshifts as a function of in the radial correlation function, the position of the BO peak in terms of redshift, and then we can convert this redshift into comoving separation. We know that this comoving separation must be the BAO scale. Probably this part is not really clear, so feel free to ask me later. Okay, so we assume here, simplifying, that the number count of galaxy is simply related to the density fluctuation of matter. In practice, this is not really true, because when we observe ratio of the galaxy, and we will also have peculiar velocity. This means that our source will not follow completely the Hubble flow, but we will have a peculiar velocity due to the inhomogeneous distribution of inhomogeneous perturbation that you will have in your large-scale structure. Let's assume, for example, that we have our telescope and that we are observing galaxy around a certain overdensity. We have that the galaxy will tend to follow the Hubble flow, but also to move toward the overdensity. So a galaxy in front will have an extra contribution to the redshift due to the motion toward the overdensity, and a galaxy behind this overdensity will receive an extra blue shift contribution to the total redshift due to this peculiar motion. So in redshift space, actually, we observe something. The correlation we observe in redshift space are different from the one that we would observe in real space if this peculiar velocity were not there. And so if we look at the galaxy number count, this effect of the peculiar velocity, gives an extra contribution to our fluctuation in the number of galaxies that we observe. And this effect has been studied for the first time by Kaiser in the 1987. And what's really important is that this effect is not just a source of error or something that we want to subtract from our signal, but encodes information on the cosmic velocity and on the relation that there is between the matter and the velocity. This is the so-called growth factor. So measuring this redshift space distortion is actually important to have extra cosmological information. And for this reason, both this baryon acoustic oscillation redshift space distortion will be measured with improved accuracy in the nearby future by the main spectroscopic surveys that we have, and here I just quote some of them: DESI, that is probably starting to be operative now; Euclid, that is a satellite that will be launched in 2022; and SKA, that is an array of radio telescopes that hopefully will start to give data around 2030. Actually, this will be the final version of SKA. There will be some precursor that will produce data before. And I think I took too much time, so let me just go to my conclusion. So I hope I made the point that cosmology nowadays is a data-driven science, that we have a cosmological model that is able to describe with a very good accuracy current observation. The success of this model comes with a price to pay, that is that there is a dark sector given by the cosmological constant or dark energy and dark matter that we whose origin is still unknown, and we hope that with the experiment that will be coming in the next decade, we will be able to understand better this dark sector of our universe. And it will be very important for the cosmology community to be able to model as accurately as possible our observable, because we will have many more data and many more statistics in our observation. And we also need to be able to evaluate as fast as possible, because when we need to fit the model to the data, this is also a crucial point. And let me say, as I already said, to explain this dark side of the universe, from the theory side, there is a huge forest of possibilities. And in particular, there are two main approaches that we can outline. One is just to say that there is, for example, for the dark energy, there is a dark component of the energy that we don't know. How do we characterize this component of the dark energy? And another approach is to say that we don't know well how the theory of gravity works. And so this means that we need to modify the Einstein field equation and to recover observations that are able to describe the accelerated expansion of the universe without a dark energy component. And there are these two approaches, and this is what is curious, that this is very similar to a situation that we also had at the end of the 19th century, where the universe at that time was given by the solar system, and we were able to observe planets until Uranus was the farthest planet that we knew. And mathematicians were able to recover with very high precision the orbits of the planets within our solar system. And there were two main anomalies in this computation that were not able to explain what we observed. One was the orbit of Uranus, and one was the orbit of Mercury. And in the case of the orbit of Uranus, this anomaly was explained by finding a new planet that was farther away than Uranus and was perturbing its orbit. And that's how we discovered the presence of Neptune in our solar system. And in the case of Mercury, the anomaly in its orbit was explained actually by a reformulation of the theory of gravity, that is general relativity. And the common point is that in the end, the answer to the question whether we need to advocate for a dark sector or change our theory of gravity is coming from observation. And hopefully, with all these new facilities that we will be able to answer to this question. And I think I'm done with this presentation. I thank you for the attention and hope it was not too confusing.
Thank you for your nice presentation. And I think our students have learned a lot of things. So we have got a few questions as we have some technical problem. So I can read it out. So, so I think you have already explained that what is the redshift, first question. And we have another question, how can we know the universe is moving? And another question, what will happen with our new universe? We got three questions.
Okay, can you repeat the first question that I didn't really understand?
What is the redshift?
What is the redshift? Okay. So can you still see my screen? Yes.
Yeah, we can see.
Okay. So probably you have studied the Doppler effect.
Yeah.
So let me see, where is my slide? Okay, so the Doppler effect is saying that basically the frequency or the wavelength of the radiation that we observe is affected by the motion, the status of motion of the source that is emitting this sound. This is the same effect that you have, for example, for an ambulance. The sound of the ambulance that is moving toward you will appear more pitched than the sound of the ambulance that is actually moving away from you. And so the redshift is basically saying whether the source that emitted this radiation is moving further away from us or is moving toward us. So what comes here is the radial velocity of the source. So when we look at the redshift of astronomical object, if the universe was static, in principle, you would expect that you will have a fraction of galaxies that are blue-shifted and a fraction of galaxies that are red-shifted. So the fact is instead that most of the galaxies that we observe, especially the ones that are farther away from us, are all red-shifted, is telling us that all these galaxies are moving away from us. And this leads Hubble to interpret this fact as an effect of the expansion of the universe. These galaxies are moving away from us because the universe is expanding. I don't know if this is answer to the first question.
And yeah, the second question may be the same. So you have already give the answer. So how can we know the universe is moving? Accelerating universe, maybe.
The thing is that it depends. Talking about a universe that is moving is a bit counterintuitive, because if the universe was moving, it means it's moving somewhere. It kind of
accelerating
outside of the universe, but this is not our picture. What we say is that the geometry of the universe is evolving, and we observe objects in our universe that are receding from us. And if we believe in the cosmological principle, we also assume that we are receding from the other object, and this is an effect of the expansion of the universe.
Okay, this may be the last question. So what will happen with our universe in the future? So,
this is of course an answer that I cannot know. Let's assume that we believe that we are in a lambda CDM model. We know that now the universe is undergoing an accelerated expansion. And so we assume that this accelerating expansion will go on also in the future. So the galaxy will keep receding from each other indefinitely.
Yeah, thank you so much for your nice presentation and discussion. So I hope students have learned a lot of things. So thanks again. And I'd like to say thanks on the behalf of the Department of Physics, Pablo University of Science and Technology. So we'll arrange another webinar with you in near future. So thanks for accepting our invitation. And bye for today. See you in near future.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye. Bye for